Good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to welcome and introduce Jean-Michel Raymond from École Normale Supérieure in Paris. I think it's a great privilege to have you here. Thanks for coming. Jean-Michel has been working in Kent TQED for quite a while. He helped pioneer this technique to work with individual atoms and photons and explore experimentally our deep understanding of quantum mechanics, which is still something not completely closed, and so has done wonderful work that you will kindly let us know about. And also I should refer that Jean-Michel won a number of prizes for his scientific achievements, the latest this year, the European Physical Society's prize, Edison Vault. So congratulations, apart from other prizes before. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Omar. Thank you, Yasser, for that very kind invitation. Thank you to all of you for coming here and attending this lecture. So we'll discuss about cavity QED, about fundamental quantum physics in cavity QED. Not so much of quantum information, though, but things which could be of interest even to quantum information people, I hope. And these experiments are basically, and illustrated here, it's a copyrighted Michel Brune, these experiments are very much about juggling with photons in cavities and playing with the field as a subject of study. And just to make a little bit of a historical introduction, it's clear that atoms and photons have guided our exploration of the quantum world. It all started with that. It all started with the two little clouds that Lord Kelvin pointed in the blue sky of fundamental physics at the end of the 19th century, the ether problem, which led to relativity, but that's a completely different topic, the blackbody irradiation and heat capacities, and it could as well introduce the problem of the atomic spectrum. And we all know that these two little clouds turned into a great storm, like yesterday afternoon, that washed out, like yesterday afternoon, I was under 18, so I am quite aware of it, that washed out classical physics, that because there is no stable planetary atomic model, because there is no consistent classical calculation of a blackbody radiation. And that led to the early attempts of quantum physics, Planck and Einstein, Bohr in 1913, and finally, about a quarter of a century later, to the real appearance of quantum physics as it is now. And with a few people who worked around Bohr in Copenhagen and who designed the formalism and tried to understand it, because it's kind of perhaps the first time in quantum in the history of physics that the mathematical objects the formalism is addressing are not intuitively directly related to the physical quantities that we can observe in the labs. So quantum physics needs a layer of interpretation to make the link between the classical formalism and the observation. And it has, of course, many counterintuitive features. We will encounter some of them. And it even raises fundamental questions about what a physical theory should be. For the first time in the history of physics, we also give up the Aristotelian determinism. It's not because we know the cause that we know the effect. At most, can we know the probability of the effects? And this is something very radically different from classical physics. And these few individuals have really changed our understanding of the world. In order to design these experiments, they rely very heavily on Gedanken experiments, on thought experiments, in which they imagine that the quantum features were kind of exaggerated, to be directly analyzed and put under scrutiny. They imagine single particle interferometers with possibly moving slits. They imagine to weigh a photon in a box to determine its presence in the box, and slightly later, Schrödinger imagined the famous or infamous Schrödinger cat cast in a quantum superposition of being dead and alive at the same time, illustrating the ridiculous consequences of a quantum. So this is weird, but it leads to wealth of theoretical success. Quantum physics explains nearly everything from the most elementary particle or even subconstituents of a particle to cosmological structures like the small fluctuations of the blackbody radiation in the sky. It's extremely precise, it agrees, we have experiments in theory that agree over 12 digits. It's a fantastic precision. And it's a universal theoretical frame to the notable expression, exception of gravitation, which is certainly one of the most open scientific problems nowadays. It's also important to realize that quantum physics led to a wealth of applications. Without quantum physics, we don't have the understanding of solid-state conduction. We cannot build a computer. Without quantum physics, we don't have lasers. We cannot measure the distance to the moon, that's one thing, but we cannot communicate on the internet. All internet communication is based on lasers at some point. Without quantum physics, we don't have atomic clocks, we don't have a GPS system. We cannot land something on a comet far, far away. Without quantum physics, we don't have magnetic nuclear imaging, and our lifetime expectancy is reduced by something like 10 or 15 years, which is kind of an important thing. And in fact, a large part of the gross product of our modern nations, so-called modern nations, originates directly from quantum application. Just as a reminder of what should be the guidance and funding system of science, this large part of our gross product originated just from blue sky research, curiosity-driven research, trying to understand those weird atomic spectra, which had absolutely no possible industrial application at the time, besides some fancy effects in the cabinet physics for laymen. And it's an astounding example, I think, of what blue sky research can give on a very long term, on a century term. And I think that should be said and said again, particularly to the funding agencies. There is no future for physics on a 5-year time scale. Okay, that was political, I'm sorry, but I think needs be said and said again if you, the young guys, want really to be able to contribute to something into physics. Another remarkable thing about this series of successes is that it provided us with tools, with computers and lasers, with tools which considerably improved, particularly in quantum optics, the experimental realm. And now, with these tools, we're in such a position that we can indeed realize the founding fathers' Gedanken experiments. We can indeed work with single-photon particle interferometers, with photons in boxes. And we can see how quantum mechanics passed the tests of realizing the really founding Gedanken experiment. You may say, why should we explore the quantum 100 years after Bohr? First, to get a better confidence in it, to understand it better. Perhaps to learn ways to teach it better. Perhaps learn a way to formulate the basic quantum postulates in a slightly more elegant or in a slightly more natural way. Also, to explore the limits of a quantum. Schrödinger cat. Why is Schrödinger cat ridiculous? Why is it that we don't see the quantum at our scale? Why is it that the quantum is vague? This is an university. And of course, we can get insights into new quantum technologies and particularly quantum information. So it's a thriving field worldwide. There are hundreds of groups experimentally working on single control artificial system. It can be photons, it can be cold atoms in lattices, it can be quantum dots, it can be ions in a trap, it can be mesoscopic circuits, and it can be cavity QED. Cavity QED is one of the very many fields in which we can realize that. And cavity QED realizes basically the simplest matter field system. We have a single atom currently coupled to a single mode of a radiation field, sustained in a modern equivalent of photon box, that's called a cavity, no relation with the tooth problem, a cavity. And with that, we can realize some of these thought experiments. And I would like to devote, of course, my talk to. So this is the plan. I will give a short story of quantum cavity QED, a few experimental and theoretical tools, how we can deal a little bit with quantum information, more recent experiment about an ideal photon number counting, some things about decoherence and Schrödinger cats, and finally, perspectives. So I'll page through that fairly rapidly, but Fatima will have a PDF of the slide, so you can refer later to the slide if you need, and you have, I will give a bibliography of it. So the very starting date of cavity QED is from an abstract for the APS March meeting of Purcell in 46, where he noted that if you put a two-level system, a spin, a qubit in modern parlance, in a cavity which is tuned to the transition, you would speed up the spontaneous emission by a factor, a Purcell factor, that is proportional to the cavity quality. And this is really the start of that. You can alter radiative properties of an atom, which are generally considered as invariant, just by putting boundary conditions in the field. Quantum mechanically, it's a very simple calculation. And this is really the start of that. It went on with papers with Casimir and Polder. The Casimir effect is basically a cavity QED effect referred to an atom. You just have the vacuum fluctuations between two plates that create an attraction of these two metallic plates. Kleppner, in 81, noticed that if you can speed up spontaneous emission, you can also slow it down by placing an atom in a metallic structure in which you just have no mode at the frequency of the atomic transition. The atom just cannot emit a photon because there cannot be any photon at that precise frequency. So this is the start of the history. The early experiments on cavity QED had been performed by Drechshager a long time ago in the 70s, where he studied dye molecules in front of a mirror. But those were rather qualitative experiments. The first manifestation of spontaneous emission has been obtained in our group in 83. So most of you were not born at that time. It's an old experiment, where we had observed that you can speed up the microwave transition by something like a factor of 500, noticeable speed. It had been followed by experiments by Demet and Kleppner, who observed 2 years later the inhibition of spontaneous emission. Kleppner basically says that atoms can live longer if, this is kind of the lifetime, if they are placed in a structure which is below cutoff for the wavelength they want to emit. But the real first insight into the modern version of cavity QED has been performed by Herbert Walther about the same year, 85. He ran the first micromaser. It's a fancy name, but basically the idea is to sustain a field in a cavity, a large field, by sending atoms one by one through the cavity. And it was the first incursion in what is called the strong coupling regime of cavity QED, a regime in which the current coupling of the atom and the field overwhelmed dissipative processes. And so it's an important landmark in cavity QED, and it's also an important and interesting quantum oscillator. I alluded to the strong coupling regime. There are basically two regimes in cavity QED. The weak coupling, in which the atom field coupling is small compared to dissipation. And in that case, there are no qualitative modifications of the atomic radiative properties, but you can, for instance, modify the spontaneous emission rate or alter the atomic energies, kind of long shift, cavity-induced long shift effect. But the most interesting is, of course, the strong coupling regime, where atom-cavity interaction overwhelms dissipative processes. And I will focus on that strong coupling regime. To determine whether you are in the weak coupling or in the strong coupling regime, you must look at the time scales of the process, at the frequency scales. There are 4 time scales in CQD. The atomic level's lifetime, which is the inverse of the spontaneous emission rate. The cavity lifetime, because photons can escape out of the cavity at some rate. And so they live in the cavity for a time Tc. The fundamental atom field coupling, which can be measured by a frequency, much more on that later, which is called the vacuum Rabi frequency. We use that instead of, most people use G, but there is only factor 2 in the definition. And finally, the last time is the atom-cavity interaction time. What are the conditions for a strong coupling condition? Omega 0 T int should be of the order of 1 for something to occur on the atom while it's interacting with the cavity. Coupling should have a large effect on the atom in the interaction time. On the other hand, the interaction time and the inverse of this frequency, period corresponding to this frequency, should be much smaller, both, than the damping times. And these are the conditions for the strong coupling. And the strong coupling has now been realized in the four main flavors of cavity QED. There are four types of experiments. Optical CQED. You put one atom with standard optical transition, principal line of an alkali atom, for instance, inside an optical Fabry-Perot cavity with a very large finesse. And then you get very, very strong coupling regime with interaction time that can reach in the second range owing to atom trapping and cooling techniques. This is, of course, the way. Solid state CQED is very interesting for practical applications. Getting entangled photon sources on a chip, single photon sources on a chip. It's very interesting for that. Of course, in this case, you embed a quantum dot, for instance, inside kind of a micropillar structure cavity. All the rates are much, much faster than for the optical transition because everything goes very fast in condensed matter, but yet they can reach the strong coupling regime. Microwave CQD, I will say a lot more on that, it's just the contrary, it's much slower than anything. It's damn slow experiments, millisecond time scales, but that leaves ample time to do interesting things. And circuit QED is just a squished version of that. It's a very active field nowadays with tens of groups working in circuit QED. Basically, it replaces the atoms by small superconducting circuits and the cavities by small resonator lines put on a chip, all that being superconducting at extremely low temperature. So I would like to focus in these lectures on CQED, microwave CQED, and discuss a few of these experiments. What are the tools? Well, of course, I should mention that you are free to interrupt at any time. I will cover what I can cover. If I go too fast, please protest. If I go too slow, please protest also. And if I'm not clear, please ask. Not so many, but... So I would like in the tools to describe two things. The experimental tools, I think you are not familiar with them. It's important to realize that these experiments, you being mostly theoreticians, these experiments are damn difficult. It's very difficult to screen a system from the outside well enough to have a well-characterized individual quantum system. Getting into the quantum is not that easy. And I would like to describe a little bit the theoretical tools I think you are mostly aware of, but it will be a fast crash course in quantum optics, basically. So this is the experimental setup we are working with, and I will detail the parts, but the core of the experimental setup is a cavity. Two mirrors facing each other, and photons bouncing between the two mirrors. And these photons are probed by atoms. Atoms that are flying across the cavity. It's kind of amusing because we use here atoms to probe trapped light. In most quantum optics experiments, you have a set of atoms in a cell, and you shine a laser beam, and the information goes out from the laser beam about the atom state. It's just the dual experiments. We trap the photons and we propagate the atoms. It's just because, you know, French are arrogant, contradictory, unlikely people, and we just do exactly the opposite than everybody else does in quantum optics. So we fly atoms through a cavity and we detect the atoms, and it's the atoms that bring information in the field and not the converse. Okay, and here we have some things that I will discuss in a moment. So what are those atoms? We use circular Rydberg atoms, a very, very fancy name, for very trivial states, in fact. The states we are considering, we are just taking an alkali atom for laser convenience, rubidium, because rubidium is very easy to excite with laser. And we prepare these rubidium atoms with a valence electron in levels with a very large principal quantum number, N, 50 or 51. We use two of these levels, E and G, with principal quantum numbers 51 and 50. And moreover, we prepare these atoms in a state with a maximum angular and magnetic quantum numbers, L is equal M equal N minus 1. It means that these levels are the closest to the old good circular orbit of the Bohr model. It means also that since these levels have all large principal quantum numbers, owing to the correspondence principle, almost all of her properties can be computed with classical models, which is kind of interesting because they are very useful to reveal the quantum features. So what are these features? Long lifetime, 30 milliseconds. We are very close to the ionization limit, but the electron is orbiting so slowly around the nucleus that it radiates very little. The acceleration is weak, Larmor formula, or Jenner-Wischer potential, if you prefer. The transition between these two levels is at 50 gigahertz, 6 millimeters wavelength. And that will prove very useful for the cavity business, as you will see. It's an exotic wavelength. It's typically 5 times the wavelength of the communication satellites, 20 times the wavelength that you have in your microwave ovens. But it's yet in the realm of electronics. If we would be rich enough, which is not the case, we could get a scope displaying a sign of 50 gigahertz. You can find that now. Very expensive. The coupling on this transition is absolutely gigantic. Why is it so? Just because the size of the orbit is very large. The size of the orbit is A not N squared. So it's 2,500 times larger than the standard hydrogen atom. These atoms are a quarter of a micron across, which is larger than most viruses, and of the order of small bacteria. So very large atoms, very large antennas, very strongly coupled to the millimeter wave field. Of course, they are very sensitive to all fields. So for instance, we can tune the transition through the Stark effect by putting the atom in the field. And finally, the electron is so far from the nucleus that the field binding the electron is rather weak, 100 volts per centimeter, typically. So it means that placing the atom in a larger field, we can extract the electron. And detecting an electron is very easy. It's a charged particle. You can detect it with near unit efficiency. So we can detect these atoms with near unit efficiency. Moreover, the field in which the atom breaks is like one the size of the orbit squared, Coulomb law. So it varies like the fourth power of a principal quantum number. So it means that it's very easy to distinguish one state from the other. So we have a single atom state selective detection, which is of course essential in these experiments. Finally, it's atoms, we can select their velocity. They fly through the experiment at thermal velocity. It's perhaps the last quantum optic experiment without cold atoms. We just use the standard sound velocity, 250 meters per second mostly, of rubidium atom at the oven temperature. Why that? Because we use the atoms to get information of the field. The faster the atoms, the more information we can extract per unit time. The more flux of bits out of the field, if you prefer. So that's kind of essential in this experiment. Well, of course, you have a price to pay. There is no such thing as a free lunch. Standard joke, I will have a free lunch at that. Okay. The preparation is a bit complex. You need to take a rubidium atom and to coax it to ingest 53 photons of various frequencies in a couple of microseconds to inflate it to this very large state. Why 53 photons? Because you have 50 units of angular momentum. And due to some section rules, we lose 3 photons in the process. The other important point is that you see that these orbitals are extraordinarily anisotropic. The orbital is a kind of tor. This is the orbital. So it's a kind of tie, bicycle tie. It's very anisotropic. And if you don't want to lose the circular nature of the field, of the atom, you may say the quantization axis is that. You need a real quantization axis, not a virtual one. So these states are only stable in a weak directing electric field. If you don't put that, they just get mixed up with the 2,500 other levels in the Stark multiplicity. And of course, you can think of that, there is a phase there, this is the exact expression of the wave function, as a kind of standing wave over this orbit, just born of De Broglie model. So it's important in this experiment to work with single atoms. And I think this is the only weakness left in our experiment. How do we prepare single atoms? We cannot. We just weakly excite an atomic beam. So the statistics in each Everything is time resolved. We prepare the atoms here at a given time with a given velocity. So we prepare a sample. But the number of atoms in this sample obeys a Poisson statistic. So the only way we have to work to operate with single atoms is just to rely on a weak excitation to make sure that when we detect an atom, it was most likely alone. The detection efficiency being not one, can reach up to 80%, but it's not one, so we can never be sure. So the only way to work with single atom is weak excitation. This is perfect for all experiments I will cover. It's a nightmare for quantum information. For quantum information, you need a deterministic preparation of the qubits. And it's very clear that if you prepare much less than one atom, 0.1, the duration of the experiment is an exponential function of the number of qubits you really require. Because you need to try up to the point where, for instance, for four samples, we have one atom in each sample. And this time grows exponentially and becomes impractical after 3 or 4. We are working on that to obviate. So now the photon box. We need a box that is able to store the photons for as long as possible. And so you need a very good mirror, a very good reflector. And the best reflector for microwaves is the metal. And the best metal is the ideal metal, it's the superconducting metal. So the idea is to go for a superconducting cavity, cooled down to extremely low temperature. It's easy to do a general superconducting cavity. Just take a bulk piece of niobium, for instance, it's a good superconductor. Modern superconductors are not good in the microwave. Okay. Just take a bulk superconductor and you dig a hole in it. But of course, if you make a hole in a massive piece of niobium, it's quite difficult to apply a static electric field to keep your atoms. So we have to go for the old good Fabry Perot French cavity with two mirrors facing each other. And then you bump in a terrible technological problem. Is that you need mirrors which are superconducting and very good superconductors, but at the same time with a perfect geometry. Because any defects of a mirror can efficiently diffract or diffuse the photons outside of the cavity and let them go in the open space between the mirrors. And it has been a long and awfully painful process to develop these cavities. And this is our own version of the Moore law. This is the cavity damping time in milliseconds versus the year. And when we started in 1994, we were at 2 microseconds. This is quite short. This is very short. It's a Q of a few 10 to the 6. It's extraordinarily short, and it was not enough, of course. It's even shorter than the mean transit time of the atoms through the cavity, which is in the tens of microsecond range. And so we worked, and we got ideas to go to 200 microseconds, then to 1 millisecond, which was enough to realize some early quantum information experiments. And finally, in 2006, we reached 130 milliseconds. And that's long. That's very long. It's a time at our perception time scale. It's about the shortest time you can think of, the tenth of a second. But it's long at the scale of the atom field interaction. So this is a very encouraging and unexpected result. We didn't think we could reach that up. Of course, extrapolations are not safe. There's a fundamental limitation, which is the finite size of the mirror. Almost impossible to compute it, because the mode is very aspheric and we don't know, but it should limit around a second. Perhaps 2 seconds, fundamental absolute limitation. So how do we do these mirrors? It's interesting. Developed that in close collaboration with people at CEA Saclay, who are interested in accelerating dark particle. We take a copper mirror, and you can get for typically 1,000 euros from some factories, a surface which is polished to an exquisite level of accuracy. These mirrors, the shape is right. This is about 5 centimeters across, and the shape is right to 300 nanometers. And the local roughness, which is just the inscription of the diamond stylus that is used to make the machining, the roughness there is 10 nanometers. Ah, yes, as you can see from scanning to needling microscopy. But of course, copper is not superconducting. So we just put it in front of a niobium bar, and we heat up this niobium bar with sputum, you're emitting far to thousands of degrees with a plasma discharge. And then we get a niobium coating, and we have the best of two. We have a good niobium superconductor and the good surface definition of a copper. And this is, for instance, the damping time versus temperature for the best cavity we had. And you see that at high temperature, the damping time is exponential. It's just a consequence of the BCS theory. You have not all particles are paired if you are at high temperature. And you can measure the gap by this thing. And at 0.8K or something like that, we operate at 0.8K with an helium-free refrigerator, we get a Q of 4.2 or 42 billion, which is appreciable. It means a finesse, we are working in order 9, a finesse of 4.6 billion. So these mirrors are about 1,000 times better than the best optical mirrors you can get. And you might be excused of this arrogance, it's the best mirrors ever. Of course, they have absolutely no practical interest. But it's plenty of time. The photons, with that finesse, the photons bounce 1 billion times on the mirror. There's a pi factor hidden there. 1 million times on the mirrors before being lost. Very good case. Another important component of our setup is the Ramsey interferometer. Before the atoms enter the cavity and after they have interacted with the cavity, we subject it to classical resonant microwave pulses. So this is something you might be familiar with. The two-level atom is basically a spin, with spin pointing up being E, spin pointing down being G, or 0 and 1 in quantum information parlance. Why is it that quantum information choose to put 0 on the North Pole is, to my opinion, a still open question. It's totally unnatural. Well, 1 should be up and 0 should be down. But, okay, they made the wrong choice at some point. Deutsch, Josiah, I don't know which one made the wrong choice, and it has been kept forever. And I may tell you that it's not intuitive for an atomic physicist for which E is up and G is down. Okay, so E is up, G is down, so it's a spin, and the pi over 2 pulse here is just a rotation of the spin. So what we make is within phases basically two successive NMR gates. And we can tune if something happens to the atom there, we get a probability from going, for instance, from E to G, that is a sine function of this phase. So it's an internal atomic interferometer, which has kind of a topology of an optical Mach-Zehnder interferometer. You are familiar with it. We split the atomic state in two, we are combined, and we get pretty good contrast interference fringes. And this is very interesting because, like that, we can read out on the atom what happened during the interaction with the cavity. And most of the experiments I will report in the last part of this talk are about that. So this was the principle. This is the student's view. It's a complex block of copper. We have two space for two cavities, only one is installed, two Ramsey zones, the circular state preparation is outside, the detection is outside. The whole thing is about 40 centimeters in diameter, 20 centimeters high, it weighs about 40 kilograms. Copper is heavy, and it's cooled down to 0.8K. Cooling it down to 0.8K requires 100 liters of liquid nitrogen and 200 liters of liquid helium. And then we remain at a low temperature forever. The last run of experiments has lasted nearly 3 years and a half with uninterrupted operation at low temperature. Because if we heat up, the cavity is mostly destroyed. Because dirt sputters. So it's a pretty complex experiment, and we have even students that go for their whole PhD without having seen the inner part of the experiment. So they play a kind of video game. Well, okay, and everything is controlled from the outside. So, little bit on the theoretical tools. How can we describe this interaction of an atom with a field? So I will page through it very rapidly, because I think you are familiar with the harmonic oscillator. And you have had a little bit of lecture on quantum optics? Little bit. Okay. So you page through that very rapidly. You can, of course, go to any quantum optics book if you are interested in getting more information. cannot make all the derivations. First, the cavity mode. A mode of electromagnetic field is an oscillator. Basically, because the energy is E square plus B square, which very much resembles X square plus P square. Well, you have to take some 10 pages of mathematics to get through that. Basically, it's an oscillator. So the Hamiltonian is just the energy of a quantum, H bar omega C, times, this should be a plus, I'm sorry, there is a low resolution problem there, times n plus 1 half, where n equals a dagger a, is the photon number operator. A is the photon annihilation operator, a dagger is the photon creation operator. I use Dirac's formalism to, you know about it? Okay, fine. The eigenstate of that are the eigenstate of n, which are the so-called photon number states, because n has as eigenvalues the integer numbers, from 0 to infinity. And this is the basis of Hilbert space. The annihilation operator removes one photon, the creation operator creates one photon, which means that all Fock states can be obtained from the ground state, the vacuum state, with zero photon, by repeated actions of the creation operator. The vacuum state is the state of the lowest energy. It's no photon. It has not a zero energy. It has an energy h bar omega c over 2, which is the vacuum fluctuation energy. In this parlance, the electric field becomes, in the Hilbert space of the operator, of the oscillator, an operator. And the expression of the operator is there. It's a linear combination of A and A dagger. It's Hermitian, so you have an I here to compensate for the A minus A dagger. What is in F of R? F of R is the mode structure. It's just the solution of the Maxwell equations for the polarization, the orientation of the field, the relative field amplitude, solution of the Maxwell equation with the proper limiting conditions. So what field quantization says is that basically there are two things to do. First, to define a mode structure. And this is a mere problem of classical electromagnetism. We take the limiting conditions and we take a basis to expand any solution in terms of standing waves oscillating at precise frequencies. This is classical. And then in these solutions, we feed the Hilbertian structure of an harmonic oscillator. So, if you want to, what is a photon? A photon is an elementary excitation of one given mode of the electromagnetic field. And with this definition, you have no problem about what is the space extension of a photon, what is the polarization of a photon. It's all encoded in this function, f of r, which is a solution of the classical Maxwell equation.
Sorry, yes? But the Helmholtz equation is an approximation. Isn't it you need something, there's a relation between the frequency and something else of the...
No, you just need to, that you have limiting conditions that define properly the mode structure. You just need the beautiful mathematical theorems that tell you what limiting conditions you need. There is no approximation behind that. Well, of course, it's non-relativistic. Okay, it's non-relativistic quantum mechanics. You may not put a photon number that is such that you could create a grand piano out of the energy of a field. That would imply some corrections. Okay, this approximation is certainly bad. It's non-relativistic, low energy. But when we work with one microwave photon at 50 GHz, the non-relativistic approximation of quantum field theory is very good. The likelihood to create a particle pair is very, very good. Okay, and E naught is just a normalization factor. F is dimensionless, and E naught is just the given by the energy of a field. E naught in the mode is the energy of a photon, and it's just in our cavities, which sustain a Gaussian mode structure with a waist W, it's just millivolt per meter. It's a weak field, but it's a very large field for a single microwave photon. This is the key of CQE. E naught is large. In order to think of the oscillator, it's useful to think in terms of position-momentum coordinates. It's useful to think in terms, in this case, of field quadratures. And the three quadratures are just Hermitian operators, which are A plus A dagger and A dagger minus A. And they just check an Heisenberg uncertainty relation over time. Just dimensionless versions of the field amplitude. And so you can think in terms of a phase space, an XP phase space, as in classical physics. And for instance, if you want to understand the vacuum state, it's a state that is on the average at zero, but which will have fluctuations because it has a finite energy. So a very qualitative picture of the vacuum state is just some fluctuations around the origin that I represent with this blob around the origin. I will give a more quantitative representation of that anyway. Okay? An important point is that the Fock states, and we will see more illustrations of that later, are definitely non-classical. Because they have a finite energy, but it's easy to show that due to the AA dagger structure, the average value of the electric field in any Fock state is strictly zero. They have no phase. They have large energy, no phase. And this is very non-classical. If you want to get something that looks more like a classical field, the one that is in the power plug there, for instance, you need to go to the coherent states. And the coherent states, I hope you are aware of them, are generated from the vacuum by action of a displacement operator, which is less unitary. Well, if you want something more classical, you have a feeling of déjà vu. If you want something more classical, you have to go to the current state that are produced by action of less unitary, the displacement operator, on the vacuum state. And the displacement operator is defined in terms of a complex amplitude. So it's unitary. What is its physical interpretation? It just boils down, it's a simple calculation, to being an actual displacement in phase space. So basically, it takes the vacuum, translates it on the x-axis by real of alpha, on the y-axis by imaginary of alpha, and it puts it here, somewhere here in the phase place. So a current state is basically a vacuum on top of a large, possibly large, classical field amplitude. And it resembles much more the standard state. The current states are eigenstates of the annihilation operator. This is their main property, can be taken as their definition, by the way. And it means that if you compute the average value of the electric field in the current state, it's just the expression of the electric field operator, where you replace A and A dagger by the complex amplitude alpha and its complex conjugate. And this is non-zero. And this is very much what you would have in a standard Maxwell mode if you express the electric field in terms of a dimensionless amplitude. Alpha. So the current state has an electric field that looks very much as a standard electric field. You can expand this current state on the Fock state. This is an easy exercise. They are not orthogonal, whatever their amplitudes, but the scalar product goes to zero exponentially if you separate them more and more. And the photon number distribution of this Fock state, the probability for having this current state, the probability for having n photon, is just given by a Poisson distribution. And for large average values, a Poisson distribution is mostly a Gaussian distribution, centered at some average values, which in the proper units is the square of the amplitude. Okay. So the higher the photon number, the higher the amplitude, and the lower the relative dispersion. Because the variance of a photon number ranges like the average value. So the relative dispersion goes like 1 over the square root of the average value of a photon number, meaning that for higher and higher photon number, the energy is more and more defined in relative terms. Meaning that for large ends, these states are basically classical states, with negligible dispersion, both in phase and in amplitude. But they are very interesting, because with the turn of a knob, we can change the current state amplitude in the cavity. How can we produce a current state? Current states are naturally produced by any classical source. A classical current oscillating at the cavity frequency injects in the cavity a current state. Lasers produce coherent states. Mobile phones produce coherent states. Wi-Fi produce coherent states. Because you have a large number of particles which radiate the field.
basically. So it's easy to produce them, and it's easy to couple them into the cavity. As you have observed, these cavities, the mirrors are not transparent. Copper 3 centimeter thick. Not very transparent to microwaves. But you can just shine many zillions of photons in the outside. And a few of them will sneak in the cavity through the same channels that account for the loss of the cavity. When a photon is inside, it can be diffracted out. So if you put zillions of photons out, they can, through the same channel, get diffracted into the room. So we can put photons in the cavity, and what we put is a current state. And just with a turn of a knob, well, everything is computer operated, but just with a mouse turn of a virtual knob, we can change the amplitude for about one photon, in which case, basically, the quantum fluctuations are as large as the amplitude. This is a very quantum object. To a field of few tens of photons, where the quantum fluctuations are much smaller than the amplitude, which is basically a classical object. So we can span the quantum to classical ring just by turning this knob, which is, of course, interesting. How do current state evolve? They just rotate in phase space at a constant velocity omega, the velocity of a cavity. Just the same evolution as the classical field amplitude. I've given a pictorial depiction of the states in terms of blobs in the phase space. This is not admittedly a very beautiful mathematical description. If you want to describe the quantum state of an harmonic oscillator, you can use the very pictorial distributions in phase space, which play very much the same role as the distribution in phase space of standard statistical physics. And the one that is most useful for us is the Wigner function. The Wigner function is defined at a point xp in phase space like the average value of a parity operator. Parity operator is just plus for all even photon numbers and minus one for all odd photon numbers. Very simple operator. The average value in the field state described by a density operator. You are familiar with density operators, of course. Density operator rho. But a state that has been displaced by an amplitude alpha, which is just x plus ip. So basically, the Wigner function is a measurable quantity. You take the field, you inject the current amplitude minus alpha, and you measure the average value of the Hermitian operator p. And that gives you the Wigner function at point alpha in phase space. And it's a very beautiful rendition of state. This is the vacuum state Wigner function. Beautiful Gaussian centered adversity. It gives some good mathematical definition of a blob that I was alluding to a moment ago. And from the density matrix, you can compute the Wigner function. But from the Wigner function, you can compute the density matrix. From the Wigner function, you can compute the average of any operator. And you can write the evolution of the system in terms of the Wigner function as a complex Fokker-Planck equation. So it's absolutely an equivalent formulation to standard quantum physics in terms of. So this is a current state, displaced vacuum. This is a thermal field, just a blurred vacuum. This is the Fock state 1. And here you see why Wigner function is beautiful. The Fock state 1 has a negative Wigner function at the origin. So here you can think of a vacuum as a field whose x and p values are basically chosen at random with this probability distribution. But here you cannot think of a one photon Fock state as in those terms, because the probability for having zero amplitude should be negative, which makes no sense. So there is a clear-cut distinction between the classical state, positive Wigner function, and any positive Wigner function is a Gaussian, beautiful theorem, and all the quantum states which have negativities in the Wigner function. So it's a clear-cut test of non-classical nature. Of course, all states are affected by dissipation. The cavity loses photon, and we have to take that into account. And that can be done in the standard Lindblad formalism. You are familiar also with that? Okay. So we can just write a Lindblad equation for the field density matrix, where the Lindblad operator is given in terms of a quantum jump operator. Kind of Monte Carlo trajectory description behind that. And what are the quantum jumps? Either I lose a photon, the quantum jump is A, or I gain a photon by creating one at finite temperature, one thermal excitation in the field. And the associated operator is obviously A dagger. And so at the end of the day, this is the equation evolution. What is interesting is that there are in this equation only two parameters. The mean number of thermal photon per mole, which is Planck's law, another expression of the temperature, just a function of the temperature. And a phenomenological factor, kappa, which is just the damping time of the damping rate of the cavity, the inverse of the cavity damping time. What is interesting is that that is given, if I know the temperature, 0.8K in our case, and that can be measured precisely with electronic measurements. Well, if we could measure the cavity, we could do that electronically, and actually we use atoms in a more complex experiment, but okay, we can measure it with classical field. So we can trust this equation very well. It means that if we trust in open system quantum dynamics, we can faithfully describe the relaxation of the field. And so it's interesting to compare what we obtain with what we can compute, just to check that. To what extent does it occur? So how do my states decohere? A single photon relaxes the average energy dense with just the cavity damping time, just relaxes as a classical field. A current state at zero temperature remains coherent whatever, just because it's an eigenstate of a photon annihilation operator. If I take a photon out of a current state, I don't change the current state. You have to think of that. Because you might be taken by the enthusiastic way, I have in a box a 10-photon current state, and I extract photons one by one, and the 10-photon current state remains impervious to that, and so I can solve the Earth's energy problem forever. The answer is unfortunately no. But I leave it up to you to think of that. It's non-trivial. Why is it no? Well, it is not. And it's not trivial why a quorum state is invariant when you remove a photon out of the current. Leave it for the discussion later. So they just damp classically, basically. They turn in phase space and go on the logarithms. Finally, the n-photon Fock state. It's easy to show from the relaxation equation that its lifetime is the cavity damping time divided by n. This is a typical decurrence effect. This is a very quantum state. And the largest the quantum state, the shortest its lifetime. Much more on that in a moment. So the two-level atom, nothing to say, level scheme, two levels, spin one-half, you all know that. What you might not know is that the dipole is just a non-diagonal operator in this basis, because it goes from the transition goes from E to G or G to E, and which polarization that characterizes the dipole amplitude, and you can look at that at the Bloch sphere. Coupling Hamiltonian, general Hamiltonian, atom plus cavity plus coupling. Coupling is just this classical coupling minus D dot E. So D is a combination of sigma plus and sigma minus, and E a combination of A and A double. Four terms in the interaction. If the atomic frequency is close to the cavity frequency, two of these terms evolve at a low frequency, two of these terms evolve at a very high frequency, which is of kind of twice the atomic frequency, if you go to the proper Heisenberg representation. So you can make the standard secular rotating wave approximation, whatever it knows. You just neglect those terms, which for instance correspond physically to the atom going from the lower to the upper state while the photon is created in the cavity. And keep only those terms which describe the right thing, so to speak. The atom goes from the upper to the lower state while the photon is created, or a photon is annihilated while the atom is excited. To conjugate terms. And the term here, which is just easily expressed in terms of the dipole amplitude and the electric field and an overlap of polarization, is just called this fundamental coupling, atom field coupling frequency, which we call the vacuum Rabi frequency. This is the James and Cummings model. There is an S there, I'm sorry. James and Cummings model, dating back from 63, long time ago, proposed at the time as a model for laser theory. Very rough model for atoms in free space. extraordinarily precise description of the cavity QED context. Because in cavity QED, we just isolate the cavity mode, the single mode of the radiation. So I introduce the atom cavity detuning. Let's look at the energy levels of that. The uncoupled atomic levels are En and Gn, which describe an atom in the upper state with n photon, or an atom in the ground state with n photon. How do they arrange? Ground state, G naught, absolute ground state. Atom in the lower state, no photon. This state is the most boring state ever. Nothing can occur because there is nothing to exchange between the atom and the field. Just spectator state. Now, we have two states, E with no photon or G with one photon. They are nearly degenerate, and they are exactly degenerate at resonance. Moreover, they are coupled by the interaction of Hamiltonian. One photon energy above, E1, G2, which are also coupled together. It means that your levels arrange in an infinite ladder of 2x2 manifolds, and in each manifold, the coupling Hamiltonian is very simple. And it's just written in terms of a Rabi frequency omega, which is just omega naught, let's forget this mode structure, times square root of n plus 1. Why? Because you have a matrix element of A and A dagger between n and A plus 1 photon. Okay? And so you can diagonalize explicitly that. It's the Dressed atom formalism that has been put forth by Claude Cohen-Danucci in his seminal PhD work at the end of, in 60, 50 something, 58. And it's a very useful model. So you can just replace E0 and G1 by eigenstates, plus n and minus n, which are linear combinations of En and Gn plus 1, and whose energy is, as a function of the atom cavity detuning, given here. The uncoupled level cross at exact resonance, the anti-cross, if you introduce the coupling. At exact resonance, the two Dressed levels are separated by omega 0, zero is lacking. Omega 0 here, omega 0 square root 2 here, omega 0 square root 3 here. This is, and this, these are just the symmetric and anti-symmetric superposition of the two states. I have I factors here and there, but it doesn't change. And it means that, for instance, if you excite with an external source, if you make the spectroscopy of this transition, you will find a doublet of lines separated by omega. This is called the vacuum Rabi splitting. And resolving it is a clear manifestation of a strong coupling regime. Okay. It means also that if you prepare E0, E0 is not an eigenstate of the evolution. You have to cast E0 on the plus naught, minus naught state, let them evolve, and compute the probability from being in E. And you will find that this probability evolves sinusoidally at the frequency omega. Far away from resonance, far away from resonance. Basically, the Dressed atoms are equivalent to the undressed, to the uncoupled levels. But they are slightly shifted by a slight bit. And this you can view in two things. I drop the detailed calculation. On the one hand, the atomic frequency changes in the field. And it changes by an amount that is proportional to the photon number plus one. Twice the photon number plus one, or n plus one half. And S naught here, it's second order perturbation theory, is just coupling square divided by detuning. It means that the atomic level change in the field by an amount proportional to the photon number in the field. This is what is called the light shift effect. It is known since the 60s that atoms placed in an intense laser field have their energy level that change according to the intensity. And this is very much the mechanism that is used for trapping atoms in laser beams. So here, we see it at the limit of a few photons. And we have a one term, which is a long shift effect. The vacuum fluctuations acting on the atom. And then we have a cavity frequency change on the other hand. If you put an atom in the cavity, since you are not at resonance, it cannot absorb or emit photons. But it's a piece of transparent dielectrics that transiently changes the cavity frequency. And the cavity frequency is changed by opposite amounts for an atom in E
and for an atom in G. It means that the index of refraction minus one of levels E and G's are opposite. And very strikingly, a single atom in the cavity has a large enough index of refraction to change the cavity frequency by much more than the cavity width, thousands times more than the cavity width. So this is also interesting. Quantum information. We did early experiments on quantum information by using precisely this Rabi oscillation between E naught and G1. And first we recorded it. It's the probability to find the atom initially in E, in level E, after the interaction time T. And you see there's current energy exchange between E0 and G1. This is an early signal, 96, but it clearly exhibits four complete Rabi oscillations. The damping here is not due to the cavity damping. Cavity damping would lead to G0. It's only due to technical sources of problem. But what's interesting is to look at the states. You start from E0. Here, at a quarter of period, you are E0 plus G1. This is an entangled state. This is an entangling gate, if you want to put it. If you go here, E0 goes to G1. A superposition of E and G goes to a superposition of 1 and 0 with the same coefficients. This is a swap gate. You take the state of a qubit carried by the atom and you put it on the cavity. If you go to a 2-pi pulse, you have this famous minus sign rotation of a 2-pi rotation of a spin 1/2. E0 goes to minus E0, E0, G1 goes to minus G1, but G0 remains G0. This is, within some modifications, a quantum phase gate. So we have all the elements to build a quantum computer. And we have made in the early 2000s some experiments about manipulating quantum information with that. Well, quite pioneering at the time, but for instance, just creating an EPR pair, you have two atoms, the empty cavity, you entangle the first atom with the cavity, and you copy the state of the cavity on the second atom. You end up having an EPR pair of two atoms. And you can play many games. We have slightly diverged from this field just because of the non-deterministic preparation of a Rydberg atom. It's impossible to go far beyond 3 qubits. And in that respect, circuit QED, mostly the ion traps, are much more advanced than what we could ever do without a deterministic atom source in cavity QED. So that's all about quantum information. Now I will get into ideal photon number counting. I would like to describe some experiments that we have performed in the last 6-7 years, which are very much the implementation of this famous Bohr-Einstein experiment. You have a photon box and you wave a box to know that the photon is there and to determine its energy. Of course, it's not exactly that, but we want to realize an ideal photon number counting. By ideal, I mean something that would give a discontinuous result, because photons are discrete, that could give, at least for a current field, a random result, because God is playing the dice behind the scene, and mostly that will give, as any ideal projective measurement should do, that will give a reproducible result. So if I count twice the number of photons in the box at a short interval, I should get the same answer. And it's clear that it's totally at variance, totally different, from standard optical measurements. And we know how to count photons in quantum optics now. We have beautiful, fancy, superconducting detectors that give you a signal that tells the photon number in a laser pulse, from 0 to 10. Very beautiful devices. But obviously, there are no photons left after the detection, because all the incoming energy has been transformed. So all photo detections are very far from being ideal. They just destroy the incoming field. They just absorb the photons. And this absorption is not required by quantum mechanics. And the first to realize that was Brzezinski in the 70s, which in the context of a very, very bar for gravitational wave detectors, realized that you can measure photons with a perfectly transparent detector that goes click when a photon goes through, but lets the photon go through. And that has been realized in quantum optics. There is a beautiful review by Grangier, long time ago, but only for macroscopic fields, where you basically just look at correlating the quantum fluctuations of two macroscopic fields in a nonlinear medium. But here, we have all the ingredients to realize this experiment at the single photon level, or even below.
as I told you, the energy shift, the energy of the atom is shifted while the atom crosses the cavity. The amount proportional to n plus 1 half. So if we send in the atom a current state superposition, a spin on the equatorial plane of the Bloch sphere, it will be, at the end of the day, in the proper interaction representation, shifted, phase shifted, around the equator by an amount that is proportional to the photon number. And phi naught here is just the coupling square divided by the detuning times the interaction time, second order perturbation flow. And you can tune phi naught by tuning delta, or to a lesser extent, by tuning Ti. So let's look at that. So, history of an atom. Prepared in the lower state, sorry, in the slide. Enter the first Ramsey zone. Tac, prepared by a pi over 2 pulse in the plus 6 direction. Enters through the cavity. Gets phase shifted by an amount proportional to the photon number. Enters the second Ramsey zone, undergoes the second pi over 2 pulse. And everywhere on the Bloch sphere. Rotation, and here I take the case where the rotation is pi over 4. So we have 8 possible states, 0 photon is shifted by pi over 8, long shift, 1 photon by pi over 4 more, 7 photon is there, and 8 photon just overlaps 0. It's an interferometric measurement. You measure phase, so it's periodic. Periodic period 8. And here you see that you have 8 states of the atom at the exit of the cavity, that correlate to the 8 possible photon numbers, from 0 to 7. But of course, detecting an atom doesn't tell you the photon number, because those 8 states are non-orthogonal. Fouchard's not measure the wave function of a single speed. This is the 10th commandment of quantum information. But there is a simple situation, pi phase shift. If there is one photon, if there is no photon, I'm not shifted. And the second pulse drives me all the way to drive me back to G, say. But if I have one photon, I'm pi phase shifted, and the second pulse drives me to E. So just by looking at the atomic state, if I have only 0 or 1 photon in the cavity, just by looking at the atomic state, I can tell whether I have 0 or 1 photon. And of course, I have not absorbed the photon. I only take an imprint of the photon through the dispersive interaction. I don't absorb it. And how can we do the experiment? We just rely on the thermal field. At 0.8k, the Planck law means that there is 5% chance of having a photon in the cavity. From time to time we have a photon in the cavity, thermal, it will remain for a time with the average of the cavity damping time, and then disappear. And the likelihood to have 2 photons is very, very, very small, because we are at such a low temperature. So we just send the cavity along seconds, thousands of atoms, going through the cycle of pi over 2 dispersive phase shift pi over 2 detection scheme, and we record the probability for being E, meaning 1 photon, or G, 0 photon. And what you observe is here, majority of Gs saying that the cavity is empty. A little noise because the contrast is not 1, but you can get rid of the noise by a majority vote over a few consecutive atoms. And then suddenly a change of origin. And then all atoms in E. There is a photon that has been born in the cavity. And this abrupt transition here is a quantum jump of light. Many people have seen quantum jump on material system, spin superconducting circuit. It was the first evidence of a quantum jump of light intensity, creation of a photon. And then this photon remains in the cavity for 0.5 seconds. It's a long-lived photon. But of course, it's an exponential delay. So you have 1 out of 10 to the 4 variations of the X photon, which can live that long. We have to wait quite a long time to get this one. It lives half a second. During this half second, hundreds of atoms cross the cavity, and all of them, besides the noise, tell, I've seen the photon. So clearly, it had not been absorbed by the atom. It proves the QMD nature of this measurement. It proves that we count the photon and not absorb it. But of course, due to cavity losses, at some point, the photon decays away. Yeah?
Sorry, this is the same photon interacting with the
hundreds
whole
of
bunches of,
yes.
Of river atoms.
Yeah. The same photon. Right. It's a constant excitation of of the cavity. Okay?
Yeah.
Which is totally different. An absorptive measurement would give one atom in E and all the next in G, which would be unseen with the kind of noise that we have. Okay? We use it. We can even play a more fancy game, which is kind of pedagogy. Here, at the time origin, we put one photon in the cavity. We do that by using a resonant atom, which emits the photon in the cavity through the resonant interaction, quantum Rabin interaction, the swap gate, and you do it. So we prepare one photon, and we just follow its intensity versus time. So this is just the result of a majority vote. And we see the photon staying in the cavity and stop decaying away at some point. And this is radically different from the solution of the master equation. The master equation says you should have an exponential decay towards a steady state, that is the thermal state, 0.05 photon. And this is not what we observe. So is the experiment wrong, or is quantum mechanics wrong? Neither. The experiment is right, and quantum mechanics is right, but they don't speak of the same thing. Quantum mechanics, master equation, density matrix, they all speak of probabilities, of ensemble averages. And quantum mechanics explicitly gives up saying anything about one precise realization of the experiment. And this is one precise realization of the experiment. How can we recover quantum mechanics? By averaging many experiments. Five is many. And you see five steps, and here the creation of a thermal photon. So you see the harbinger of the thermal equilibrium. But yet it's a staircase. 15 looks a bit like the exponential damping. 1,000 is exactly the exponential damping. And this is computed with no adjustable parameter. It's a perfect fit. I think this experiment is interesting for first-year students. Well, not the details of how it's obtained, because that's a dirty master's degree level thing, but it clearly shows the difference between single realization and ensemble averages. And that quantum mechanics is only about ensemble averages and not about single realization. And it fits very well with the theory. So we can count from 0 to 1. It's okay, and computer people say it's enough. But I would like, as a physicist, to count from 0 to 7. So go back to the pi over 4. And then it's difficult because those states are not orthogonal. So one atom doesn't tell the whole of the story. But it's not a problem, because the atom doesn't change the photon number that it wants to measure. So we can use not one atom, but many atoms sent through the cavity to guess what the photon number is from many measurements. So once again, we put a pi over tuples that maps some of these states onto a great circle of a sphere. So basically, the second Ramsey pulse and the state selective detection, we have a fixed rotation of the Bloch sphere, plus a detection of the z-axis. It's elementarily equivalent to detecting the spin in the equatorial plane in the Bloch sphere along a direction that I can change at will by choosing the phase of the second Ramsey pulse. So I will only discuss in terms of the equatorial plane and the Bloch sphere. Very clearly, detecting one atom is an ambiguous measurement of a photon number. It's not a weak measurement of in our own of parlance, but it's yet something that, for all practical purposes, is weak. And it should be described by a generalized measurement. So basically, rho is transformed into the sandwich of rho between measuring operator. These are dirty details of quantum optics, but basically it says that the measurement is defined by a POVM, which two elements that correspond to the atom being detected in E and the atom being detected in G. And of course, an atom undetected doesn't change anything. And if you boil down all the... I skip everything. Here is the essential part. While I have detected the atom for some setting of a Ramsey interferometer in one of the states E and G, I change my knowledge of a photon number distribution. The new photon number distribution is the old photon number distribution multiplied by the probability to get the result I got in an exact field of n photon for the setting of the interferometer. That Bayes' law, that mere Bayes' law, the conditional, the new probability for having n photon is given by Bayes' law about the old probability of having n photon. And finally, most of the weird consequences of quantum measurement, most of them boil down to the very counterintuitive features of Bayesian. It's counterintuitive because it's a product of probabilities. It's highly nonlinear. So it's difficult to understand from there. You have many classical examples. Let's put that in more vivid elementary terms. Imagine that I know nothing about the field. I know only that it's between 0 and 7, because in the experiments we manage that. So I just put a flat distribution between 0 and 7. And I detect, I set up the detector so that I get the atom in E if I have 4 photons, in G if I have 0 photon. And somewhere in between for the other photon numbers. What the thing says is that this probability is a sine function of A. So detecting the atom multiplies the probability distribution by a sine function. And basically, if I get the atom in E, I have a larger probability to have 4 photons. Because 4 photons for sure give E. And I have nearly zero probability to have 0 photon. Because 0 photon would give G if the experiment was perfect. It gives G with a large probability if the experiment isn't perfect. So you see that detecting the atom in E makes the distribution more precise. It's more peaked than 2-4. Of course, detecting the atom in G has the converse effect. It makes the distribution closer to 0 or closer to 7. Okay? And I can resume that many, many times. I can send many atoms, and each time I multiply the initial photon number distribution by a new sign. So at the end of the day, the final photon number distribution is the product of very many signs. And it can be shown that that converges if God is playing the dice behind the scene. According to the rules of quantum physics, there is a hidden Markov process or hidden martingale. Beautiful mathematics, I don't understand them. Read this paper if you want to understand. And you get that in all cases, it will converge at the end of the day to a Dirac distribution to some photon number. Precisely. And thus we have realized the experiment. This is, for instance, one realization of that. We send about 100 atoms. Why 100 atoms? We want, from statistical measurement, to distinguish 8 states. And with the square root of n thing, we need at least 64 bits of information. And we put 110, because it's the speed limit on the French highways. It's easy enough to remember. We could have taken 130, which is on the autostrade. But, okay, never mind. And what you see here is the inferred photon number distribution in one realization. Flat initially, we know nothing of the field. Then we multiply by a sign. Then we multiply by another sign. At some point, we rule out some photon number. Only 4 and 5 are left. You could think that 4 will win, but it's like in football, you never know. And in fact, there is a goal by 5. Goal! And then it's 5 that wins, and at the end of the day, we have 5 photons in that case. Of course, it doesn't prove. And this is one realization. If you restart the experiment many times, you get photon number distributions. You can compute the average of this photon number distribution, plot the histogram of these averages, and you find that you get integer results, which is not a priori coded in the theory. You get integer results, and you get integer results within some knowledge. There are some cases in which it fails, with a probability distribution that is in excellent agreement with the current state that we have put in the cavity to start. So we measure, it's probabilistic, and of course, I have not, the signals are a bit complex, we have repeated the experiment. We can repeat the experiment and show that if we measure 5 at a given time, we still measure 5 immediately after. So it's an ideal QND measurement, and it leads to a very efficient Fock state preparation. We perhaps keep that image. We can image the Wigner function of the Fock state, just for that. This is the free photon Fock state. Oops. Free is like that. Okay, this is the 4 photon Fock state, Wigner function. And we see what it should be. It has rings of negativity. It's very non-classical. So those states are extraordinarily non-classical. They should be prone to decoherence. And I think we have time enough to discuss a little bit about decoherence, very much in the parlance of Zurek.
I don't see if you have seen it, but there is a beautiful paper by Zurek in Physics Today this month, or last month, because I get them with at least a 1 month delay. There's a beautiful about decoherence, Heisel selection, and quantum Darwinism. And I recommend the, well, very, very interesting paper. Decoherence is all about the Schrödinger cat problem. Decoherence is all about the fact that we do observe in our at our macroscopic scale only a small minority of all possible states. Because no macroscopic object is ever in a quantum superposition of states. There is no cat that is dead and alive at the same time. I am not here in Paris at the same time. Well, at least I hope. And the reason is that a complex quantum system is necessary, the reason for the decoherence persons, is that the quantum system is necessarily coupled to a wide environment. And it's impossible to totally screen a large system from the environment, be it only because at the end of the day, a large quantum system at least interacts with gravitation. It's impossible to hide its state because of a gravitational interaction. Well, fancy thing to go to gravitational interaction in quantum physics, but weak gravitational interaction is there. If you have well-controlled microsystems, they can be decently, as I've shown, isolated from the environment. But certainly not a cat. And so, decoherence might help in understanding that. We don't have a general theory of decoherence, I think, but we have beautiful models in a variety of situations, Brownian motion of particles, harmonic oscillators. We have an explicit model of the Lindblad equation. And these models have shared some characteristics which led to think that there might be something very fundamental and very generic. In all cases, they find that there are only a few states that are stable or nearly stable with respect to relaxation. They are called the pointer states. And that all quantum superposition of those pointer states are extraordinarily rapidly transformed into mere statistical mixtures. The cat dead and alive, dead is possible, alive is possible, but dead plus alive is rapidly transformed into either dead or alive. You don't know because you don't have the information. In fact, just statistical uncertainty. What are the pointer states? Well, for Brownian motion, for instance, it's the position eigenstate, which is a near pointer state because, of course, there is a small diffusion, but diffusion is slow. Open a bottle of perfume in the room and you will measure up to which point diffusion is slow. For our quantum field, the exact potential at zero temperature is the vacuum. But the current states are decent pointer states. As I have shown, they remain coherent, and only the amplitude is decaying, but it's decaying very, very, very slowly. They are decent approximate pointer states. And the idea of quantum Darwinism, I have no time to enter into that in too much detail, but the key idea of quantum Darwinism is that the pointer states are selected by the interaction with the environment. These are the states which are able to disseminate copies of themselves in the environment, in all the modes of the environment, without ever getting entangled with the environment. And it's precisely the way current states are relaxing. They send away in all modes of the environment small, tiny current states. And it means that those states can be assessed objectively. Two separate observers, accessing two sets of the environment modes, can look at these two sets and infer from this operation what is the state inside the cavity, and we'll get the same result. So there is quantum objectivity into this state, and this is a very important point also. Look at that paper by Zurek. Very interesting. There is an RMP paper also. And pointer state superpositions, once again, are very rapidly transformed into statistical mixture. What is important in the decoherence model is that there are two time scales. There is the mundane time scale, that is the time, the decay time of the energy. For the current state, it's the cavity damping time. For Brownian motion, it's the damping time, it's the viscous motion in the gas. And there is the decoherence time scale for superposition of pointer state that depends upon the separation of the pointer state. The more widely separated the pointer states you want to superpose are,
the fastest is the decay of the superposition. So it's a non-trivial. People now use decoherence as a word for a spin 1 alpha relaxation. I would say, I'm not into a beautiful clear-cut definition of the word, there is some ambiguity. But the spin 1 alpha, the two time scales are equal, just because it's a microscopic system. But when you go into the macroscopic realm, the two time scales are very different. The T1s and T2 are fundamentally different from a system that is macroscopic. And so decoherence says two things. It says first, and it's important for quantum measurement, because quantum measurement, if you imagine an Hamiltonian interaction between the measured system and the measuring device should be in a state superposition, which is obviously macroscopic. So decoherence tells us two things about that. First, that there is no state superposition of the meter system. This is very much the Bohr measurement postulate. It's either one state or the other with some probabilities. And so God is playing the dice, but with a classical dice, which is good, because we can still keep being not totally crazy. And also that decoherence finally determines the measured quantity. To determine the measured quantity, you need to know what is the interaction with your measuring device and what are the pointer states of the measuring device, because those are the states you will observe at the end. So you need to know both if you want to know what you measure in a measuring system. Can we observe decoherence? Of course, we have a beautiful state for that. We have a Fock state. They are non-classical. They can be large, and we can prepare them. So can we monitor the decoherence of the Fock state? Yes, we can. We can follow, for instance, the number of photons in the cavity versus time. We keep sending atoms in the cavity, and then each time, from the last 100 atomic detections, we determine what the number of photons is in the cavity. And we resolve, here we have 7 photons initially. By the way, there is here a repeated measurement, so it's 3 and 3. And you have the escapes of the photons one by one out of the cavity. And you can make statistics of the photon emergence. We did that in a kind of integrated way. And you can reconstruct the evolutions of the probability from being, for instance, in 2, 1, and 0 photons versus time. And you can feed that to a model. And you can, from that, infer that the life damping rate of the n-photon Fock state is linear to the function. So it decays n times faster as the classical energy. So this is very clearly a decoherence effect. But the Fock state is a Schrödinger cat for all practical purposes, but it's not a very lively Schrödinger cat. It starts like a complementarity story, this experiment about Schrödinger cats. You remember this discussion by Bohr of an interferometer with a moving slit. The moving slit records whether the particle has gone from the upper and the lower slide, and that precludes the interference fringes. We did that experiment. The picture is not appearing and it has disappeared from there. Okay. Never mind. Not very important. I made a mistake somewhere. We have this Ramsey interferometer. 2π/2 pulses, final atomic detection. This is an interferometer. And I will put a measuring device to try to guess what is the internal atomic state in between the two zones. If I can make this guess, then for sure I should not have any interference. If I cannot, then I could have interference. And what is the measuring device I put? A current state in the cavity. A current state in the cavity, it's an arrow in the phase space. In a dispersive interaction, if the atom is in the upper state, it will get a negative phase shift. If the arrow is in the lower state, we get a positive phase shift. Okay? So this is a kind of needle, the amplitude of the field, of needle in phase space, which tells you the atomic state, which correlates to the atomic state. It's a measuring device. It's a prototype of a measuring device. If the phase shift is small, the phase shift is smaller than the phase uncertainty due to the vacuum fluctuations of my current field. And then I have no information about the atomic state. I should see fringes. If the phase shift is large,
The two final states of the cavity field corresponding to the two levels are orthogonal. They have performed the measurement. I don't need to read the measurement out. But they have performed the measurement, and that should preclude the observation of fringes. And that phase shift, I can change it easily by changing the atom cavity detune. And what we observe is there. We see fringes if we put no field in the cavity. If we put a field but have a lot small phase shift, we still see fringes. But as the phase shift increases, the fringe contrast decreases. And you see directly complementarity at work. You see directly how which path information encoded in the field alters the visibility of the interference fringes. And you can feed that qualitatively, quantitatively to the theory. Seeing the disparition of a signal is not a signal by itself. It has to disappear in the proper order. So many ways that an experimental signal could disappear. So this is interesting, but what is even more interesting to look at is what is left in the cavity at the end of the experiment. The atom has gone, the interferometric cycle has been measured by the cavity field, and is finally detected. When I detect the atom, I get an answer, E or G. But the answer doesn't tell me anything about the state of the atom when it crossed the cavity, because it has undergone a pi over tuples that has completely mixed the atomic levels. So when I detect the atom, I guess that I will project the field onto a current superposition of two states with different phases. This is a Schrödinger cat. Well, no, free photons, Schrödinger kitten, the thought of a kitten, a little fraction of a kitten. It's very small, but yet it's something that is larger than a single photon state. It's mesoscopic, if you take mesoscopic in a very wide sense. And so you expect that that should be prone to decoherence. Can we monitor this decoherence? So this is an old experiment that dates back from 96, observing the decoherence of a meteor in quantum measurement. Experiment that received a bit of attention at the time. How can we monitor the decoherence? By making the portrait of a cat. We have a technique to measure the Wigner function, which is very basically based on this idea of translating the field and measuring the parity operator. Well, we can measure directly the parity operator, but something that looks like a bit of Max-like work, we can measure the Wigner function. So we can image what is in the cavity just at the end of this experiment. Pi over 2, dispersive interaction, pi over 2, detection in one of the states. And here is what we get. We get exactly a cat. A cat is made up of two ears, which are slightly curved and oriented towards the front. And you see those two ears, which are slightly curved and oriented to the front. The two ears reveal the two possible values of the field phase. This is a projection in phase plane. You have either that amplitude or that amplitude. And they are not exactly phase opposite, but nearly phase opposite. 0.8 radians between them. Instead of 0.8 pi radians, instead of 1. Okay, never mind. And in between, the other important components of a cat are the whiskers, or the smile. And here you see interference fringes, very beautiful interference fringes, with big negativities. And those interference fringes tell you what you have in your cavity is not either this phase or the other, a very mundane state, but really a current superposition of both of these states. Real mesoscopic quantum superposition. Of course, if you would have a statistical mixture, it's easy enough to prepare it, you have only the ears. The smile is off. And what is even more interesting is that we can do that in a time-resolved way. So we can make a movie in the life of a cat, a movie that is about 1,000 times as slow as normal, when you see an important thing in this movie, is that the smile is disappearing first. The interference fringes are washed out in a time of the order of 20 milliseconds, which is much shorter than the lifetime of the energy, 130 milliseconds. So it's a kind of duel to the Cheshire cat. The Cheshire cat, impossible to pronounce that correctly in front of an English person. The Cheshire cat is the smile that disappears least. The Schrödinger cat is the smile that disappears first. And this is a beautiful illustration of decoherence.
Because Vestae, the size of the cat, should be measured as the square of the distance between the two ears in phase space. It's 12 photons in that case. So it's something that is admittedly a bit mesoscopic. And we see clearly that the lifetime of the current is much, much shorter, by a factor nearly 10, than the lifetime of the energy in the cavity, which is very much a direct illustration of decoherence effect. Of course, more experiments and checking that in more detail, decoherence like 17 megahertz. So it's kind of interesting that finally, decoherence is very strongly linked to complementarity. Why is it that the cat decoheres? It's because it's a non-classical state, it's not a pointer state. It gets entangled with the environment. The environment gets information about the state, but in getting entangled with it, so when you trace out the environment, your state is lost. So if there is decoherence, it's a complementarity effect. The environment knows in which state the cat is, and that precludes the superposition state. And of course, complementarity, and it's also because the state is entangled with the environment. So decoherence, entanglement, and complementarity are finally the three sides of the same triangle, with superposition in between. No Masonic thing there. So I think it's time to conclude and to open some perspectives. What are we trying to do now? We have moved all our experiments to Collège de France. Moving experiments like that is a well, it's kind of interesting business, but it's over now, and we are trying to recover from the move, so to restart the experiment. One thing we have in mind is to have two cavities. We have had that in mind for 20 years, since we started this experiment, basically. It's very difficult, because it's square more difficult than having one cavity. We still hope to be able to do that, and what is the interest? Try to put a state like that. A state that would be a cat. It's either the same phase in the two cavities, but either plus phase or minus phase. Or it's a current state in one cavity or in the other. And the vacuum in the other. Alpha 0 plus 0 alpha. Those states are interesting. Why? Because they are mesoscopic. They decohere. But they are also non-local. They are EPR. They violate the inequality. What is the interplay of locality and entanglement and decoherence? That's something that is certainly interesting to me. We have another experiment that is underway, and we'll say a little bit more this afternoon about it, with atoms, very slow atoms in the cavity. Now we have used fast atoms that just rush through the cavity in tens of microseconds because we want to extract information out of the cavity as fast as we can. But of course, we don't take benefit of all the lifetime of the atoms. And it would be fine to have atoms in a fountain arrangement that would just go up in a free fall and have the turning point of their free fall inside the cavity. It's kind of Rosetta Philae mission, you see. The G is higher. Okay. And so that we could have extremely long interaction times in the tens of millisecond range, comparable to the lifetime of the adult. So there are many technical changes, but with that we could get to extremely large cats, hundreds of photons. And we could make a decoherence map. Very precise decoherence process tomography to check that we understand decoherence. Is there something beyond decoherence? Many people advocate that there are extra terms in Schrödinger equation, that gravitation plays a role. It's interesting to look at that. And we can also play with quantum Zeno dynamics, more on that this afternoon. So this afternoon I will discuss, there will be a feeling of déjà vu for those of you who plan to attend the two events, because some there will be a difference, so I will re-explain all of Q&A. So good news if you have understood nothing. Bad news if you find it boring. And I would like to speak about optimization of Q&A measurements and combating decoherence with quantum feedback. Okay, bibliography. You have this book, which has been published by Oxford University Press and that you can find for free on some Chinese websites, in spite of my continuous efforts to save my income from this book. Well, if you want to make a fortune, never write a monography. Okay. Write some Harlequin-style book, it's much more, okay. Which contains the principle of all these experiments. Not the actual experiment, it's been published in 2006, so it's a bit outdated, but at least the principle is there, and all the lengthy derivations of quantum optics
are given then, it's also a parameter of quantum optics, and there are many, many references in that, most of them being correct. Before concluding, I should say that I'm not the only one involved in this job. It's a teamwork along the years, and a teamwork with Serge Haroche and Michel Brune. This is not our lab, and this is not our standard dressing in the lab, but from time to time you go into fancy places where you need to be dressed properly. It's the only time in my life I found myself elegant and beautiful. So we have worked with Serge together since 76. So it's a long, long, long collaboration and friendship. And Michel joined us a few years later. And this is the team. This is the team in another occasion, about at the same date. We don't drink champagne every day, in spite of being in Paris. Well, Vino Verde is not bad neither. Okay. We don't think so. And the experiments so are led also by Sébastien Glaise, who designed this cavity experiment, Igor Dotsenko, who is in charge now. And of course, we have many, many students and postdocs, Stefan Gerlich is a postdoc, working with us. Could be open positions, of course. We have also an experiment on superconducting atom chip. I will perhaps allude to it this afternoon. We have strong collaborations. We need collaboration. We have collaborations in the cavities with the CER people. They made the mirrors for us. And at the end, we pushed them so hard that they gave us the machine to make the mirror. Because we are calling every morning, can you make a mirror pair? Okay, so they gave the machine. On feedback, we are working, I'm sorry, this transparency is in French. This is very weird. On feedback, we are actively collaborating with mathematicians. From time to time, you need to interact with mathematicians, even if you are an experimental physicist, because as you will see this afternoon, feedback mechanisms are not that simple in quantum optics. And in QZD, we have a strong collaboration with Paolo Facchi and Saverio Pascasio in Bari. We need funding, of course. And you need time to make these experiments. Serge started the group when he came back from his postdoc with Art Shallow in 73, in what was at the time the Laboratoire de Spectroscopie Hertzienne de l'École Normale Supérieure, led by Kessler and Brossel. And since then, all these people have worked in the team for at least a year. Some there could go to the Raoul left, Theo left, Carl Eisenberg and Adrien are about to leave. And some stayed in the group, the ones in violet. So you need time and you need to accumulate expertise to realize experiments in quantum optics. And I think it's not by chance that Serge got the Nobel Prize together with Dave. Why not the ion traps? There are, of course, strong similarities between the systems. Dave stores the ions forever and studies them with lasers. We store the field, not forever, admittedly, and we study it with atoms. And basically, he did the Schrödinger cat about at the same time as we did. He did all the experiments we do can be cast directly in terms of ion traps. But not all experiments of ion traps can be trapped. They have an extra counter-rotating term that is interesting. Okay, never mind. But basically, it's the same experiments. And interestingly enough, it's also the same group structure. Dave in NIST, he could stay in the same institution for years, more than 40, I think, now, with the same team of people. Itano, Berquist, Bollinger, working for tens of years together. And many brains is much more efficient than one brain. So science needs time, science needs stability. Science needs long-time project, and it's that produces scientific results and the harsh work of all the PhD students. So thank you very much for your attention. Sorry for being over time.
Thank you very much.